Hello, my name is Robin Hizme, and I'm pleased to give the introduction to The Tragedy of King Richard III by William Shakespeare for the Shakespeare 2020 project. This is my favorite history play, and it was quite popular in Shakespeare's own moment. Not only was it published 5 times in quarto version during Shakespeare's lifetime, but the character of Richard III survives in a funny and salacious anecdote about Richard Burbage, one of the main players in Shakespeare's company. This play is actually 4th in what we now consider Shakespeare's minor tetralogy, a sequence of 4 history plays, starting with Henry VI, parts 1, 2, and 3, with Richard III as the 4th and final play, chronicling the lengthy struggle among 2 branches of the royal family for possession of the English throne, the Lancastrians, symbolized by the red rose, and the Yorkists, symbolized by the white. Richard III presents the resolution of this conflict in the Battle of Bosworth Field of 1485, when Henry, Earl of Richmond, a descendant of the Lancastrian John of Gaunt, defeats Richard III, a Yorkist king. The Wars of the Roses are ended when Richmond marries Elizabeth of York, thus uniting the 2 houses in the newfounded Tudor dynasty. Henry Tudor, Earl of Richmond, thus becomes King Henry VII, grandfather to Queen Elizabeth, Shakespeare's monarch at the time of the play. Part of the appeal of this play for its historical audience and the vogue for English histories in general at that time is the growth of patriotic sentiment after the defeat of the Spanish Armada in 1588 and a validation of the idea of national unity and identity at the start of Elizabeth's 4th decade as England's queen. Shakespeare adeptly manipulates his historical sources, condensing, foregrounding, and fabricating versions from Moore, Holinshed, and Hall to dual purpose. For the business side of the theater, he creates a dramatically appealing stage Machiavel. And this villain's overthrow at the end is presented as a divinely sanctioned victory, which serves the legitimizing narrative of the Tudor origin story. It is to the main character of Richard that I will now turn, while pointing out some interesting structural features to watch out for. If you have been staying on track with the readings for the Shakespeare 2020 project, you may recall that at the conclusion of Henry VI, Part 3, Richard meditates on his deformed condition, seemingly dismissing kinship networks and blaming his isolation and villainy on his deformity. Richard is a vice figure whose means of obtaining political power are hidden under a guise of innocence and masterful public relations, but seemingly writ large on his deformed body. This play's opening soliloquy reaffirms Richard's debased nature, as he opens by confiding with the audience, almost as if we were co-conspirators, about his nefarious plans. The arc of his character relies in part on this patterning. Richard always discloses his intentions before enacting them, and I want you to pay attention to how your incredulity or horror is often mitigated by the admiration he must command as a consummate rhetorician and manipulator of affective response, starting with his undetected conspiracy to murder Clarence and the successful wooing of Lady Anne. In addition to this recurring character pattern, many motifs repeat in parallel scenes, although often with divergent results. Some examples are the wooing of Lady Anne and the later wooing of Queen Elizabeth and her daughter, actually. Queen Margaret's prophetic curses contrasted with her later consolations for the woman, or the nexus of ghosts, dreams, and omens in scenes with Clarence, Stanley, Richmond, and Richard, especially the 2-tense scene on the eve of the battle, where the binary between good Richmond and evil Richard is blatantly reinforced. These examples also serve to highlight the intense thematic focus on the potency of language. The play is a powerhouse of classical rhetorical tropes. I often have students identify these in the wooing scene to analyze Richard's persuasive tactics. The play engages us in the purposeful deployment of rumors and fake news, attesting to the power and danger of dissimulation and easily swayed public opinion of the masses. Whether it is accusing Mr. Shore of deforming his arm through witchcraft, claiming that the princes are illegitimate, or spreading the news that Queen Anne is sick unto death, Richard is a master at creating false reports in order to provide public license for his criminal activity. I'll let you think about the potential parallels with our current moment. This is highlighted with regard to the spectacle of power in the central act of the play, where he and Buckingham stage direct the mayor's proffering of the crown. Flanked by two clergymen, Richard feigns religious devotion and reluctance, which only strengthen the people's desire for him to rule. But while the play concludes with a seemingly clear-cut trial by combat, in which Henry VII emerges as a national hero for vanquishing the evil and deformed Richard, the play does not simplify the struggles of political power along extremes of good versus evil. Rather, with the figure of Queen Margaret and the parallels drawn to earlier events in the Wars of the Roses, we are presented with two sides whose actions are less than admirable. Furthermore, our identification with Richard, even as we abhor his malevolence, leads us to contemplate his monologues, where he offers interesting and compelling psychological motivations for his behaviors. And the play as a whole asks us to investigate moral choices, whether it is the second murderer's sudden attack of conscience before murdering Clarence, or Buckingham's hard line against killing the princess. It seems that even villains have internal conflicts over where they place the line. Despite the excessive villainy of Richard III, or perhaps because of it, this is definitely my favorite history play. Richard's unabashed theatricality is alluring. He is the villain I love to hate. I hope you enjoy him as well.